road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again.
Hey, we're back like we promised you we would be. And if you're watching in the morning time, it's good morning, good morning, good morning. If you're watching in the afternoon, howdy, folks. We're glad to have you all tuned in to All About Country with Ken Rainey, Keith Ballard, and my friend Roger Smith over here on my left and your right. How you, Roger?
Doing great, Ken. Happy to be here as usual.
We're in the main Temple Theater. We've been in a little offshoot of the Temple Theater, but now we're right in the middle of it with this big scene in the background. It looks beautiful. Looks like New York City, but we're down in Meridian, Mississippi. Keith, how are you?
This brings back so many memories. I can remember those upper balconies where I would smash popcorn boxes and rain terror on girls in the floor seats.
And that's where you got your first kiss, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yes. Is that all you were doing up there, Keith?
Listen, I was driving a girl home from a date, and a highway patrolman pulled me over and said, "Hey, pal, use both hands." And I said, "I can't. I got to drive with one." I'm sorry, Ken. We're not here to talk about my love life.
Hey, we're here, y'all, and I'm glad y'all are here. And we're going to tell you some more stories about some of these super legends of country music that performed on this stage behind us so many times, and we're so glad to have them. And we're going to tell these stories in episodes, and so that you can keep up with what we're talking about. Keith, I wanted to congratulate you on your St. Louis team winning the Super Bowl. That's real nice.
Super Bowl.
Isn't that St. Louis?
That's St. Louis, but that's the World Series, Ken.
Oh, that's baseball team, and I thought it was football.
Earth to Ken.
Woo! So today we're going to talk about Willie Nelson.
All right.
And one of the nicest human beings there is on Earth. And you wouldn't know it by the number of years that I tried to obtain him to play the Jimmy Rogers Festival, but that wasn't his fault. It was his management people. You know, I found out through the hard way that booking agents and management don't want you to come to Meridian and do a show for just expenses.
Right.
They'd rather you be playing somewhere for a lot of money.
Exactly.
So I'd call Colorado. I mean, I bet you I called Colorado 100 times, and I wouldn't even get the time of day. They would turn me off before I even said hello. And that was Willie Nelson's manager. And so I couldn't get anywhere, Keith.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Like your first
date. You understand that.
Like your first date.
Yeah, it was hard to get a date. And I know you know more about that than I do. But anyway, let's talk about how I finally obtained Willie Nelson after trying for 5 long years to get Willie Nelson. I heard he was going to be performing over in Jackson, Mississippi at the Coliseum. And so my sister was in radio, as well as I was in radio, and you were in radio and TV, both of us. And we had a face for radio better than TV.
Tell me about it, Kenny.
But anyway, I called my sister over in Jackson, and I said, "Look, Willie Nelson is someplace in Jackson in one of the hotels. I need you to find which hotel he's in, and if you can, find out what room number he's in." And she said, "Hold on just a minute. Let me think about this." She said, "Our newsman just came in from interviewing him.
Wow.
He'll know what room he's in and what his phone number is. I'll call you back in just a few minutes." And she called me back, and she's definitely a Rainey. She had already called Willie Nelson in his room and said, "My brother's been trying to get you for 5 years, and he needs to talk to you." Now, that's a true sister right there.
Yeah.
So she gave me his phone number, and she said, "He's waiting on your call." So I'm at the radio station. You remember that old production room we had right there next to the control room?
Yeah, it came over on the Titanic.
Anyway, I went in the production room in case I could record him saying that he would come.
Right.
And I didn't know what he was going to say. And I was shaking. I was so scared to call him. But I did call him, and he answered the phone. He said, "You must be Ken Rainer." And I said, "Well, I am." And I said, "You are one hard man to get a hold of." And he said, "Well, how long have you been trying?" I said, 5 years. He said, "Well, you got me now. What you want?" And I said, "Well, we're doing the Jimmy Rogers Festival over in Meridian, and I've been trying to get you because I know how much you love Jimmy Rogers, the father of country music." And he said, "I do." And he said, "I'd love to do that festival with you." He said, "But my band is leaving after the show tonight to go back to Texas." My immediate response was, "We don't need your band. We need you."
So what, you had a band to back him up?
No, I just wanted him and that old guitar he plays.
Oh, I got you.
That's all I wanted.
I got you.
And that's how I came.
Wow.
With just him and that old guitar. But long story short, he said, "My wife and myself are going on one of our honeymoon trips, and we're going to be coming right through Meridian tomorrow morning, and I'm going to stop and I'm going to do your Jimmy Rogers Festival."
Amazing.
And it was amazing. So I said, "Well, Willie, nobody's going to believe me that you're coming to do Jimmy Rogers, because, you know, I just couldn't get in touch with you."
Right.
I said, "But I'm in the production room. Would you record, just say something like, 'Hi, this is Willie Nelson. I'm coming to Meridian to the Jimmy Rogers Festival.'" He said, "Turn that tape machine on." And he recorded that.
That was smart.
Well, he recorded
yeah.
it. And I went in. The control room was right next to that old production room.
Right.
And I told Gail Harper, he was on there, and I said, "Gail, play this as many times as you can between now and 5 o'clock this afternoon." So
sure.
He burned up the airways with that tape about Willie. I drove to town, and the crowd was around in front of
wow.
WTOK
already.
TV.
Already. Wow.
In about 15 to 30 minutes.
Wow.
And we sold that show and the second show to the rafters in this theater. We didn't have a seat. I had people calling me all over town wanting seats, and we didn't have any.
Amazing.
I mean, it was sold out.
Amazing.
And the backstage over here to my right, it had so many people in there, I couldn't hardly move.
Control it.
It was just,
wow.
It was amazing. And when we announced Willie to come on stage,
yeah.
him and that guitar, this crowd
just
went
wild.
Absolutely crazy. It went wild.
So
I'm brave, and I got Willie to do all this stuff, and when we come back in just a few minutes, I'm going to tell you the next part of that big story that happened with us and Willie. Well, you know, we was talking about Willie performing here in the Temple Theater, and I was going to tell you, as Paul Harvey used to say, the rest of the story, and that is that while I had him on the phone, I said, "Willie, I hear that Jerry Jeff Walker is playing the show with you tonight in the Coliseum." And he said, "Yeah, he's playing the show with me." I said, "Well, I was just thinking, since you're coming over here, he might be willing to come over here." He said, "Well, here's his phone number at the Holiday Inn, room 222 in Jackson."
Wow.
"And you call him and you say, 'Jerry Jeff, Willie told me to call you and get you to come over and play the Jimmy Rogers show tomorrow night.' And if you say Willie said it, he'll probably come." So I called Jerry Jeff Walker, and I told him exactly what I just said. "Well, Jerry Jeff said, Willie asked you to call me?" I said, "Well, otherwise I wouldn't have your number." He said, "Well, if Willie wants me to be in Meridian tomorrow night at Jimmy Rogers,"
wow.
he said,
"wow,
I'll come." So he said, "But this is the condition." I said, "Well, what's the condition, Jerry Jeff?" He said, "You have a limousine parked at the front door of the Holiday Inn in Jackson at 12 o'clock noon. And in the back seat, you have two cases of beer, iced down. And I'll come sing for you tomorrow night in Meridian."
Wow.
And he did.
Wow.
And had no beer when he got here.
Oh, good Lord. Is that true?
Yeah, it's true.
And that's an hour drive.
Here's a mic stand right here. And we had a mic stand in front of them, and I understand they didn't bring a band, but Jerry Jeff had his guitar, put the mic stand in front of him, and put a mic to pick up his guitar, and he would lean this way, and then he'd lean this way, and finally we took somebody out there to stand behind him just to hold him up.
Oh, well, God.
But now he didn't miss a note on Mr. Bojangles.
Amazing.
And he was the top recording artist of that song.
I remember that.
Probably sold 50 million records, and so it was really great.
The new band Bojangles and dance for you. Born at you. Silver hair, a ragged shirt, and baggy pants. Did the old soft shoe jump so high, jump so high. Then he light a touchdown. Mr. Bojangles.
And we were talking about Willie. You had a opinion of how Willie would have been in his early days.
Well, here's the thing, Ken. All this was put together impromptu.
That was.
Okay.
Yeah.
Basically, I've always thought that people who do things impromptu in broadcasting or TV had radio experience.
True.
And I looked it up. Willie Nelson was an announcer for a little old bitty station in the state of Washington. 1,000 watts,
yeah.
Daytime only.
We remember that, don't we?
Yes, we do. And he was able, and we as our broadcasters, we're able to do things spur of the moment without a script, such as this show here today. We have no script. There's nobody telling us what to do.
We can't read if we had a script.
So, well, Ken, that
he's not right. Joking.
Now, you're right, Keith. Willie did have a background of radio. Coming up.
And I think that helps you, because how many remotes were we on where we had no script and we had to talk for hours?
Do you remember us taking a set of portable turntables out and play records from the location?
Yes.
That's another story.
I wish we had those now.
Yeah,
I wish we had those now. Yeah.
Because they would be antiques.
Yeah, exactly.
And I love antiques because
that's what my wife said about me. I love to collect antiques.
So Ken, wasn't there a time when Willie Nelson came through Meridian many years ago? And tell me about that.
Yeah, I will tell you about that. And, of course, we're talking about Willie and Jerry Jeff both in promptitude, like you said. I don't know how to use that word. But they came and did the Jimmy Rogers shows. But early on, Willie Nelson was coming through Meridian trying to get to Nashville. And he ran out of money when he got to Meridian. So he asked some people, said, is there a country station here? And they said, yeah, it's up there on 9th Street between 22nd and 23rd Avenue. And he said, well, do you know any of the people? And they said, yeah, Claude Gray's on the air right now. And so Willie said, well, I need to go up there and see them. They country music, they'll know me. And so he went and visited the radio station. He said, look, I need to sell y'all a song. What do you need to sell us a song for? He said, well, I don't have any money to get to Nashville, and I need $50 to make it up there. So Claude Gray and a couple announcers pooled their money together and got up to $50, which was very hard to do. But they did raise $50.
Wow.
And they bought a song called Family Bible. And Claude Gray went to a little studio, and he recorded that song that Willie Nelson wrote. And they put their names on it as writers because they had bought the song. And they would get the publishing rights and the
Amazing.
Credit for the writers, which was the income from that song.
And that's the way, does it still work that
well,
way, man?
Yeah, if you put your name on a song, whether you wrote it or not, you get the credit.
Really?
And you get the money. So anyway, they bought it for $50, and Claude Gray went and recorded it. It went to number one on all the country charts, just like
overnight,
that quick.
I can see
around the table, when from the family Bible Dad would read.
So, in years gone by, Willie was a great writer. You came up with and asked something about that this morning.
One of my favorite Christmas songs of all time is Pretty Paper.
And he wrote it.
He wrote it, and Roy Orbison first recorded it. But Ken, I found out later, this actually was a true story. Willie Nelson ran up on this fellow in Texas who was paralyzed from the waist down. That's all he could do was sell paper and pencils. And he thought, this is a guy that could be on public assistance, but he's out here selling things that people want. And that's how he came up with the song of Pretty Paper, which, as you say, would bring a tear to a glass eye.
When I was a little boy in Fort Worth, I was born and raised there, and I remember that guy. We would be by Leonard's department store.
That's it.
And there was him, and there was a blind couple that sang religious songs, and they were real loud. And I remember they had on these big green sunglasses. But this young man, he was on his knees, and of course his face was about at my height, and it was real frightening. And he had this box with pencils and stuff, and I looked into it, and he was a nice guy, and he had been married 7 times. Had children and everything.
As nice as Willie Nelson is, he probably, after Pretty Paper, sold all the millions and millions of records that sold. I bet you Willie went back and bought him that hotel.
Probably.
Probably so, yeah.
Because you know Willie would do that.
That's it.
He was very nice.
Pretty paper, pretty ribbons of blue, wrap your presents to your darling from you.
One other story about Will Nell. I mean, this man is the nicest man that you will ever visit with.
Wow. Right?
And he played this stage at the Temple Theater 3 times. Now, and he came and he hosted the golf tournament. He's just a nice man.
He really is.
And I can't tell you all the details, but the IRS decided they would investigate Willie Nelson, and they did that. And they made him sell all of his property and all of his stuff. And was it Dale Royal that was a coach at?
Dale Royal, Texas.
Dale Royal, and he was a football coach.
Right, for the Longhorns, yeah.
For the Longhorns. Well, he went to the auction that the IRS had, and he bought all that stuff back.
Gosh.
And then after they left, he gave it back to Willie.
Is that where Willie came up with that song, Take All of Me?
And they did, boy. They took it all. It's kind of like you've been on your knees a long time. Like
my ex-wife, Take All of Me, yeah. Wow.
Anyway, he went to Nashville with that $50, and he wrote a song called Four Walls.
Yeah.
And Farron Young recorded the
song. Is that really the way?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Willie. He got to Nashville and he wrote Pretty Paper and wrote Four Walls, wrote Crazy for Patsy Cline, wrote all these big songs. But to start with, he had trouble raising money to do what he needed.
He was a writer. He was like one of the greatest.
And he had a recording contract with Monument Records back in the early days. But for some reason, it just didn't click, even though he was writing all these great
songs.
He was
in a black suit and just always so formal.
He was sharp as a tack. So Farron Young recorded Four Walls.
That's amazing.
And so I think it was Four Walls. I hope I'm not wrong.
Well, that was a great song.
I think that's right.
You're right.
And so later on, this song went to number one and went to number one, went to number one, and it sold millions of records.
Yes, it did.
So you know what Willie did?
No telling.
Well, Willie got famous, and Willie had a lot of money. So he went to an auction because Farron loved
memorabilia
bulls and the cows and all that stuff. So Willie went to an auction where they were selling prize bulls, and he spent $10,000 on this bull.
Gosh.
And had it shipped to Farron Young for recording this song.
Wow.
Isn't that something?
That is. That's great.
But he is one of the greatest human beings ever.
Yeah.
Ever. Really, I wish y'all could meet him right now.
Well, me too.
But he is a great individual. You know what? It's so much fun having Keith Ballard and Roger Smith here with me.
Thank you, Ken.
All this stuff, it's just like Roger said and Keith said, you can't write this stuff down. It just happens.
Exactly.
And when it happens, we hope it's good.
Yeah, it's carried exactly. on an American tradition that's happened since the founding of this country. Telling stories
that's
from one
true.
Generation to
Very
another.
True.
And these stories need to be told, Ken.
Yes,
well, you know,
right.
these stories that we're talking about, they only occurred between myself and the legend artist
right.
that played these stage here at the Temple Theater. And there are other stories about Willie Nelson. But you know, sometime I think, like we did some episodes on Merle Haggard. Well, we talked about Merle quite
right.
a bit. But when you get to the status of Merle Haggard and Willie Nelson, you can't get no bigger.
Exactly.
I mean, that's about as big as you're going to
exactly.
get.
Exactly.
Now, there are some stories we're going to tell about the most beautiful lady in country music I have ever met, and that's Loretta Lynn.
Loretta.
And, of course, she just passed away
yeah,
recently.
Yeah.
And Tammy Wynette.
Oh, yeah.
And all these people played this beautiful Temple
You knew
theater,
them all. You knew them
and
all.
And I had relationships with all of them
yeah.
once I got them to come and perform for Jimmy Rogers Festival. And, of course, we did it over 30 years. So we got a lot of stories we ain't
exactly.
even started telling yet. And so you might get tired of us, but we'll be back like a bad dream every time. So y'all just hang in there with us. And we're going to continue to talk about Willie Nelson a little bit because I'm telling you, this is one great guy. He's written so many million-selling songs and recorded so many great songs. And we're going to play some of those in our episode today. We're going to play On the Road Again.
Yeah.
You remember that?
Oh, yeah. Man, that's a, yeah. Now you're talking, yeah.
But you know, the one that just really takes me back, it's called You Were Always On My Mind.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe I didn't love you quite as often as I could have. Maybe I didn't treat you quite as good as I should have. If I made you feel second best, girl, I'm sorry I was blind. But you were always on my mind. You were always on.
So we're going to play a couple of songs for you in this episode. But tell me about this now. We realize that Willie is in the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
He's in the Songwriters Hall of Fame. And now you tell me he's nominated for something else.
The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Dolly Parton recently got chosen for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And that just shows you about Willie Nelson and Dolly Parton, of course. They're not just country, but they have crossover. And Ken, when you and I were doing that show, you would play country, of course,
sure.
but you had some crossover hits that really blended
yes.
in. And that's why there's a big movement between now and May for him to be put in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Well, I sure hope he makes it. And you know, he's following in the footsteps of the guy we've been talking about. Jimmy Rogers was Hall of Famer with the Country Music Hall of Fame, first inductee. Then he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Then he was inducted into the Blues Hall of Fame. Did I say Songwriters? And he's in the Songwriters Hall of Fame. So he's in all those Hall of Fames. He should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Well, Willie, now, if the movement continues, this started a groundswell that he should be in there because not only he sang them, he wrote them.
Oh, my gosh. You know, it's kind of like coming back again to Merle Haggard. He wrote all the things he did. He recorded all the things he did. He played the guitar on all the things he did and the fiddle on all the things he did. That's really like Willie Nelson. I mean, well, nobody can play the guitar like Willie.
When God was handing out talent, he stayed on those guys a long time.
Oh, he did. He worked, a lot of long time for it.
Amazing.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
And just to think, Roger, all these guys played on your stage.
Yes, they did.
In the Temple Theater.
And the thing that amazes me is that Willie Nelson, being one of the best songwriters ever, he made the transition, which it's a real hard transition, as we know, because we have a lot of songwriters here.
Sure.
That they write a lot of songs, but to become a performer, you know, we've talked about it. And I guess Willie just had what it took. And, you know, I know he had problems initially, and then once he changed his persona.
He felt like that even though he had a Monument record recording contract and they weren't selling. But all of his songs were getting recorded
by other people.
And he felt like if he could get out of Nashville and move down to Austin, Texas.
I remember that.
And then he grew some long hair, kind of like Oswald. He got this long hair.
Yeah, I remember.
And he
all
learned
that.
How to play that guitar better than any guitar player in the world.
Yeah, he did.
And he still plays the same old guitar that he started.
Yeah, I remember that. Kind of has a hole in it.
It's got a wore out hole in it. And but he is a great instrumentalist guitar.
So does he still live in Texas?
Lives in Austin, Texas.
He does. I know he was born in Abbott, Texas.
What's the name of the river there that everybody goes
Trinity
to?
River? Brazos River?
No, it's a big
Pardinalis River.
Yeah, that's where he lives.
Pardinalis
River. He got his golf course out there.
Wow.
And when you go to his golf course, they have to run the deer off of it to play golf.
Amazing.
And if you drive by that golf course, which I've done, you're going to see about 10, 15 deer out there in the middle of the golf course.
Beautiful.
It's beautiful.
It's a very rustic area, but in that it's real pretty too.
But I keep coming back to the same thing. They should put him in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame because he's qualified to be there.
Sure.
And as I said early on in this program, the way that man is so nice, he ought to be able to do anything he wants to do.
Did I ever tell you I auditioned for him, Willie Nelson?
No, what'd you audition?
Right here in this studio, right here at
what'd
the stage.
Do?
Well, I started to sing, and he said, Mr. Ballard, you should be on stage. It leaves at 3.
And he hopes you're on it.
And we had stage coaches back then.
Yes, we did.
That's when that was.
You know, that brings another story when you say stagecoach, and Keith will remember this. During Jimmy Rogers' days, there was an old stagecoach down at, what's the name of that springs down there on going south?
Oh, don't let me lie. I can't think of it.
Walkaway. Lake Walkaway.
Yes.
And this guy had a dude ranch down there.
Yes.
And he had an old Wells Fargo stage.
Huh.
So we went down there and we talked him into putting that on a trailer and to bring two of his horses and another trailer. And we hooked them horses up to that stagecoach. And we rode in the parade and
what?
We rode everywhere. And we would sell a live broadcast at stores like TGNY. And we'd pull up out there in that stagecoach and we had them cowboy hats on and we were decked out. And we'd do a remote there, and then we'd go out to West Building this
yes.
year, and we'd do a remote out there.
Amazing.
We were all over town.
You worked so hard.
And we had a lot of fun doing that, and the people would go crazy about us doing that kind of stuff.
Of course.
We pulled up down there in front of Wideman's, and the horses, you know, you couldn't tell them when to use the bathroom.
Oh,
they
right.
decided at Wagman's, that's where they
oh,
needed
geez.
To go.
Oh, my God.
And so we're out there in the middle of the road. I'm really surprised we didn't get arrested.
Yeah, I can imagine.
But there would be policemen and police cars that would actually get in front of us and turn on the blue lights.
That's because Meridian City is very helpful, really.
But we had more fun with it than anything.
Yeah.
And of course back in those days at Jimmy Rogers, we would have a street dance right in front of WTOK TV.
Right.
On a Monday night, Sunday we'd be in Highland Park, Tuesday night we'd take a break, and on Wednesday night we'd come to the temple and do the gospel night. And then on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, we had all these superstars.
It was a happening place.
Oh man, this place would be packed to the, I mean, you couldn't get another seat.
And I think that you played a major part in creating all that.
Well, I don't know that. What I did.
Yes, you did.
But I was persistent.
Very persistent.
If I wanted you to play the Jim Rogers Festival, I didn't take no for an answer. And that's one of the funniest stories we're going to ever tell is about Loretta Lynn.
Yes.
It is the funniest story.
I
and
can't
I don't
wait.
Know if Keith's heard that story or not. We're not going to tell it today.
No, I don't think I have.
Oh,
I want to hear
it's
it, though,
funny.
When we get to that point.
And the story I'm going to tell about Tammy Wynette, who to me was the greatest ever. We're going to tell a story about her sitting on the steps over here. And my advice to her, and I wasn't a doctor, but I thought I was. And I gave her some great advice, and she didn't take it.
You told her?
Don't tell it. It's going to be a surprise.
Okay. A cliffhanger.
We like surprises.
It's a cliffhanger.
Yeah. We like surprises.
Well, Ken, you was talking about Stagecoach. One of the remakes of the John Wayne movie, Willie Nelson, was in Stagecoach, the movie.
I did not know
In fact,
know
it
that.
Was on the Circle Network just this past week. He wrote the music with David Allan Coe, and he was in there with John Schneider, and it was a great movie, and he sang the lead song,
okay.
Stagecoach.
I did not know that.
He was multi-talented.
Oh, man, he did. See, Keith's got all this knowledge. That's
yeah,
really
he
not,
does.
I don't have any knowledge, but I know a lot
yes,
of stories.
Yes, you do. You have a lot of knowledge.
I know a lot of stories. And we're glad you're watching.
Yes.
Hope
yes,
you're
I
with us
that,
from now
that.
On. We'll be joining you on YouTube at All About Country with Ken Rainey, Keith Ballard, and Roger Smith, and we'll all be here to tell you stories about people and things that happen in this beautiful Temple Theater. If you ever come to Meridian, Mississippi, see if you can get on one of the tours.
Yep.
You've got to come see the Temple Theater.
Oh, it's gorgeous. And I love this old street scene because it brings back a lot of memories for me.
Yeah, it's original.
For about 30 years, I had songwriters, and we would put the songwriters
in front of we still do.
In front
we
of
still
this,
do.
Yeah.
Can you see that building right over there? That's where the police stopped me a few weeks ago and did a search and seizure.
Yep.
And a woman
officer. Search and what?
Search and seizure. It was women officers training. They searched me, and I had a seizure. Noted that out.
Oh, y'all don't miss a single episode of All About Country
I'm
with
sorry,
Ken Rainey.
I'm sorry, disease. I can't help it.
Keith Ballard and Roger Smith. It'll be coming to your favorite place on YouTube. Goodbye.